Good afternoon, everyone. This is Ishani with IME Professional School. So today we are going to conduct a webinar on Excel Macro and its usages in analytics. These webinars are a part of a regular webinar series in which we are going to cover up a lot of tools which are related to analytics industry. So let's start with the Excel Macros and its usages. Now, the first question that comes to our mind is, what is macro? Macro is something that can help us to automate our stuff in Excel. Anything that we are doing in Excel, which takes about a lot of time and it's a regular process that we are doing day in and day out, what we can do through this tool of macro, we can record the process, we can record the steps, and we can run all the process or all the steps by running or calling this macro. So the work that we are doing in half an hour or 1 hour, we can actually record it, and once we run it, it happens within few seconds. So this is the usage of your macros. Now, there are certain things that we are going to cover over here. Now, macros are a tool which are very easy to use, very helpful, and the advantages that we get when we are using macros in Excel is, first of all, you don't have to do your own work because Excel is doing it. Second thing is, it saves us a lot of time. Anything that I was doing in half an hour or 45 minutes, now with the help of a macro, gets reduced to within a second. Third thing, since the human intervention is not there, because this is when you record a macro, a code gets generated at the back end. So this code runs, and hence your errors becomes less. So these would be some of the advantages of using macro. A simple example would be on saving time. Like when you're going to work in analytics industry, you will be catering to a lot of data. Now this data is not going to be stored in Excel itself. This data may be stored in some of the softwares, because your team may be working in different places in India or abroad. So a centralized place will be there where we are storing our data. Once we want to do any kind of reporting or any kind of analysis, then we are going to download the data in Excel and then we start working on Excel. Right? So once you're downloading the data in Excel, the first thing would be to format the data according to your need. Because you have to understand, this data is sitting online for every user, not specifically related to your field of work. So once we download it, first step that happens is we have to clean up the data. Now this cleaning of the data is the first and the foremost step before you can do anything else in Excel. And this cleaning of the data may vary. It may take something like a half an hour, depending on how much you have to clean it up, how many rows you have to delete and columns you have to delete, or it may take up to an hour or so. So instead of wasting our time in doing something which is not even, you know, contributing to our actual work and which is redundant in nature, as in I have to do it every day in and out without any brain work, I should be recording macro for such process. Okay. Before we are going to get into macros, very important thing is that we can record a macro in two ways. One is an absolute macro and one is called a relative macro. Now, what is the difference? Because before we actually start recording a macro, we have to tell the Excel that whether you want it to record as an absolute or a relative. Now, as the word absolute suggests, absolute means fixed. It's fixed. So what do you mean by absolute? If I'm recording something in an absolute mode, my macro actually remembers the cells that I worked in. If I started working something in B2 and I worked all the way my way to H2, my Excel is going to remember these cells. And when I start to repeat the process in Excel through your macro, it only works in those particular cells. So in absolute recording, what happens? The cells that we worked in while recording, Excel would work in those cells only while repeating the process. Right? And what happens in case of a relative macro? In case of a relative macro, the macro is going to start working from any cell that you place the cursor on. So it is not dependent on the cells that you worked in. Let's say we were working in cells B1 to H2 and I want to repeat the process in B3 to H3. So I cannot work in the same cells again and again. For such processes, we record our macros in relative mode so that whatever is my current position of my cell in Excel, that takes up as a starting position and I can run my macro efficiently. Any questions so far? Because this is very important, because even before you can start recording a macro, you have to decide whether it's going to be a relative recording or it's going to be an absolute recording. Now, over here, you see an example where I've dumped the data from a software, and the way the data got dumped is in one particular column. So, I've got the first name, last name, street, city, state, zip code, phone number, and the two email IDs. Now, even before I can start working in Excel, I have to rearrange this data so that my Excel works. I can do sorting, filtering, VLOOKUP, all those kind of things. So, how would you rearrange? I'll have to transpose this. What is transpose? Making anything vertical to horizontal or horizontal to vertical. Changing the alignment. So, for transposing, I would copy this. Go to one cell on the top. Right click. Do a paste special. And in paste special, you will find an option of transpose. So, we are going to transpose like this. So, this process, once I've done, then the data that I transposed, I'll go ahead and delete the data. And the same process, I have to repeat for the different datas till I'm able to finish my work. So again, this is a process which is same, repetitive in nature. Nothing different is happening. So instead of doing it myself, even though this process is going to take 5 minutes, why waste 5 minutes when I can do it efficiently within seconds? So I'm going to record my macro for this. Now you've seen the process that I've done. What do you think it's going to be? Whether it should be absolute recording or a relative recording? Relative recording. The reason is, what is the reason of relative recording? Because if I'm starting from the cell B2, when I'm recording the process in my macros, I would have already utilized the row 2 in transposing my data. Now next time when I want to work on the other data, it is not going to be in row 2. I would want it to work in row 3 and row 4. So each and every time when I'm redoing the process, I want to do it from a fresh cell. It's not the same cell that I'm working in. Hence, in such a situation, it has to be a relative macro. How do you make a macro recording relative? The macros are going to be there in the view tab. Extreme right, you will see macro. So you have view macro, record a macro, and right below you have use relative reference. This is like a toggle button that you can turn on and off. Okay, right now, since I did not click on it, it is on the absolute mode by default. If you have to convert it into a relative one, all you have to do is click on it. If you see it very carefully, now around that icon where use relative reference is written, a green border has come up around the icon. When you see that green icon, it's kind of that you've pressed the button inside. Right? And that tells us that it is a relative macro. If I have to turn this relative again to an absolute mode, I'll go ahead and click on it again and it is back to an absolute mode. Once I have made my reference as relative, it will remain relative till I turn it back to absolute. So it's not that if I'm recording 5 macros in this particular workbook, again and again I have to go and turn it to a relative or an absolute macro. Once I've picked one, it will remain there till I shift it back. In between recording, you can always go back and forth between relative and absolute. I may have a program where certain things have to be from a fresh cell all the time and certain things have to be in the fixed cell all the time. So I can do a combination recording also. Okay? Now, before we start recording, a couple of important things to make sure, because recording of a macro is relatively very easy. It is easy because you know the process and you first, the recording over there, right? Now, the problem is if you are not doing some pre-processes while you're recording a macro, it may not run very efficiently or it may not run at all. Few things that we will consider while recording a macro is, first of all, you have to think about which is going to be your start cell, which is going to be your end cell, and what is going to be my selection method. So these three things we will consider even before we start recording a macro. And definitely you have to do a dry run of your process to make sure that we don't make any errors, okay, of the process. In the sense, that if I have whatever the process is, like in my case, I am copying it, I am transposing it, I am deleting the copied data, and then I'm moving on to the next one. So this is a process. Now, until unless your process is very clear in your mind, you will tend to make mistakes. Unfortunately, in macro is a tool without any brain. So whether you take a right step or you take a wrong step, macros cannot differentiate between it. So it's going to record everything. All your wrong steps will also get recorded in it. So we have to be ultra careful to make sure that we are doing everything right. No wrong steps should be there. If you do a lot of mistakes, then your macros do not record a good code and hence they do not run properly. So that is why very good idea is, first of all, like I did right now without recording it, I just said, okay, I'll copy this. I understood the process and I'll move one cell up, I'll transpose, I'll come one cell down, I'll delete my data and then move on. That is very important. Now, why is the starting cell very important? Now, the starting cell is going to become more and more important when you are doing a relative recording. In absolute recording, it doesn't matter, because in absolute recording, it always remembers the cells that you're working. So I don't have to worry too much where my cursor is placed in the starting of the macro, because as soon as I run the macro, it is always going to go to the right position. However, in the relative macro, like we have said, it starts to run from where my cursor is. Now let's say I started recording my macro and my starting position is over here in I5. So the first logical step that anyone would do in this case is go to the data to do the process, right? Now once I move from I4 to B2, is this a step for a macro or no? It is a step for a macro. Macro wrote a code according to it. Okay. Now when I've done this process, the second time when I want to run the macro, I would not be in a corresponding column in I. I would be in my next cell, next record. And now when I try to run this macro, the first step that my macro remembered was move so many rows and column to your left. And now there are not so many rows and columns to my left. Hence, it will give me a runtime error. So even though it's a very, it's a very redundant step for us, like it's not a step. I just moved to where the data is. But for Excel, for your macros, this was considered as step number one. So you have to be careful where your starting cell is. So if this is where I'm going to work, my starting cell, I chose to be B2. So before I start recording, my cursor has to be placed at the proper position. Next thing is the ending cell. Again, I have to decide when I stop recording my macro, where I would end my cell. Now let's see, again I'm repeating the process, copy, go one step up, transpose, delete entire row, and now this is the way it is ending, it is selecting couple of cells. Now if I would have stopped recording over here, every time I run my macro, this is the ending position that my macro will leave me on. And if I have to start running my macro again, I have to go ahead and again pick this one cell to start working. So unnecessary, I'm going to introduce a manual step into it. Just because I didn't choose an ending cell properly before stopping my macro. So I should have ideally picked this cell and then do a stop macro. Otherwise, every time it's going to choose a bunch of cells, 4-5 cells, and every time I'll have to pick the cell from where it should start working and repeat the process again and again. So I'm reducing on the efficiency, because why we're using macro is to make it to reduce on the time that we are spending in doing the process. And if we are doing this manual process in between, I'm not utilizing my macros efficiently. So this is the reason your ending cell has to be decided. Now the third thing I spoke about is the selection method. A selection method becomes crucial in terms of how my macro is going to work if I have a different kind of data. For example, right now, if you look at the data, for each record, I have got 9 fields, right? And the same pattern is observed in the records below. So I can choose my data as I can use my shift key and the down arrow key and choose them one by one. That's one selection method. The other selection method could be if I use control shift down arrow key. Now, what is the difference between these two selection methods? Except for the part, it is quick, because that quickness is for a user. Yeah, that makes a difference to me, that I'm doing one by one, more effort by from my side, versus I select and I press a control shift down arrow key, less time. But in case of Excel, how it is treating it?
It's selecting the entire range.
Till what? In which? Till the
end.
How do you define the end?
Till
the blank space. So when I'm doing a shift control down arrow key, the selection method is that I'm going to pick n number of cells till I hit an empty cell. Versus if I do a shift and down arrow key one by one, right now my Excel is counting how many cells are there. So it is going to count 9 cells in the first method. I'll say 9 cells are there. Now, if I would have recorded my macro with this selection method, what happens? Let's say in the record below, the 9 cells are not there. They are only 8 cells. So what will macro do? Macro cannot differentiate that I recorded for 9 and now there are 8 fields. So let me reduce one. No. It is going to go ahead and pick all the 9 cells and transpose it, even though it means picking an empty cell or picking data from the other record. Right? So what we should do, depending on what kind of data you have, if I have a static data, I know throughout it is of the same dimension, doesn't matter. But I should be always focusing on making my codes a little more dynamic. Right now I wrote a code where 9 records are there throughout, fine. What if in future I got the similar problem with 11 fields in it or 5 fields in it? Then I don't want to re-record my macro again because I chose a very static method of selection. So if I would have picked control shift down arrow key till it hits the empty cell, I can use for n number of fields in a record. So that makes it pretty dynamic in nature. So these 4 things we have to understand even before we start recording a macro. Because if you guys don't focus on these 4 points, then the problem is you are going to record a macro, which again I'm telling you, it's a very easy job. Because what you do, you start the recorder and you start doing what you do in Excel. But the problem is the code that gets generated in the backend is not good. And hence, in future, when you want to run this macro, it would not run. So keeping all these 4 things in mind, I've already picked my start cell. I've picked my ending cell. My ending cell is going to be the empty cell before the record, just because that happens to be my start cell again. And selection method, I'm going to use a dynamic one. So I'm going to use my shift control down arrow key. And then I've already understood what the process is going to be. The 4 things I know, and once I know these things, I'm going to start recording. So I've placed my cursor at the right place. We discussed that this is going to be a relative macro. So before I start recording, again, I have to make sure that the relative referencing is on. I do that. This is a right starting position, and now I'll go ahead and record a macro. So once you record a macro, this is the dialog box that comes up. First thing is, give a macro name. As a rule, try to give a proper name to your macros. Because once you get a grip of the macros, you will try to automate everything that you are doing in a daily life, which is, you know, repetitive in nature. And you would not remember, even after 2 days, what did macro 1 was meant for, what was macro 2 meant for, what was macro 3 meant for. But if I give a proper name, such that when I read the name of a macro, I would remember, okay, I recorded this macro for this particular purpose. I can utilize it better. So give a proper name, like I'll give transpose data. And please make sure we are following all the rules that are there in naming things in Excel. Like there are no spaces, no special characters, no starting with numbers. And only thing we can utilize is an underscore. Then we give a shortcut key. The whole purpose of recording a macro is to reduce time. So instead of going in the backend where my codes get generated and then running from there, I can give a shortcut key. So once I press the shortcut key in Excel, my code will automatically run. The shortcut key that you can give is anything from small a to z or a capital A to Z. Nothing more than that, only one character. Let's say if I give control Y. If I had to give a capital Y, I would press a shift key on my laptop and press Y. So now the shortcut key has become control shift Y. So control with small ABC or control shift with capital ABC is what you can do. What if I give a shortcut key of Control C? Now Control C happens to be a hotkey in Excel. What it does? It copies. Now if I associate this shortcut key to my macro also, and anytime I run my shortcut key, which one will be given preference? My macro or it will copy? Macros. Macros are given more importance in Excel. Okay. So all the shortcuts that you're giving to your macros, they can actually go and overwrite all the hotkeys. So don't worry too much and take out the cheat sheet where all your shortcut keys are there. Just remember the shortcut keys that you use in your daily life. And if, don't name them those. And if it's anything else that I don't use, like I don't have a habit of using Control N, which is to open a new workbook, then I don't care if Control N is a shortcut key for a macro. In case you give a wrong shortcut key, I'll tell you where to go and change your shortcut keys also. For now, I'm going to give a Control Y. Now, when the macro is going to run will depend on how you're storing, where you're storing your macros. Now, the three places where we can store our macro, this workbook, new workbook and a personal macro workbook. I'll tell you what it means. Let's say we are recording in this workbook. So if I'm using this workbook, that means I'm recording in the workbook that I'm working. The name of this workbook is macros. I've recorded in this. And since I'm saying store in this particular workbook, the code that gets generated, like I told you, whenever you're recording, a code is getting generated by Excel. The code that gets generated is also kept in the macros workbook, which I'm recording in. So this is this workbook. Now, what is the use of it or why does it matter where it is stored? It matters because when you run a macro, when you call a macro, this particular workbook in which the code is kept has to be open. So you have to be very well aware where the code is kept. When I say this workbook, my code is kept in the workbook that I'm doing a recording in. So if I have to run this macro, I have to make sure that macros.xls has to be open every time I'm trying to run this macro. If this workbook is closed, wherever you want to press Control Y, it doesn't matter, it won't run. And as long as this workbook is open, your Control Y would run on any worksheet, on any workbook. Okay, now if I do something in new workbook, if I'm storing it in a new workbook, in this case, I'm doing the recording in this particular workbook called macros.xls. But the code that will be kept, as soon as I click record in a new workbook and click OK to start recording my step, what will Excel do? Excel will open another new workbook in the backend. And the code that gets generated is put in that new workbook. Every time I record, a new workbook gets opened, a new code gets in one particular workbook. So this is given to the new workbook that opens in backend. So even if I close this macros.xls, it doesn't matter. As long as that new workbook is open, my macros will run. So where I've recorded, that file can be closed. But my code is kept in a new workbook that has to be saved and open so that I can use it in future. So that is a new workbook. And if I store it in something called a personal macro workbook, we record in macros, and the code is kept in a common VB editor. VB editor is the backend of Excel, from where you do coding and you can automate things in Excel. And there is a place where you can keep a code which is common to all workbooks. Now if I store something in a personal macro workbook, it gets on the backend of the common VB editor. Now what happens because of that, irrespective I open this workbook where I've recorded or I close it, this macro is always active. If I press Control Y anytime in my Excel, the macro will run. Because it's not being stored in a particular workbook, it's stored in the backend now. Backend and common to all. So these kind of things I would say when you're starting, please do not store your macros in personal macro workbook. And there's a very good reason. When I run my macros in Excel, my control Z key, which is undo, stops working. So whatever macro does, it does. You cannot revert back. No, you can't undo it. Only thing I can do, I can close my file without saving it. But then I'm losing things that I wanted to save also. So you have to be a little careful with your macros. So that's why if I, let's say we created a macro in which I'm deleting certain data, cleaning rows and columns, and I record it as a personal macro workbook. And control Y is a shortcut key. Now this shortcut key is not a very tough key to press accidentally. It's very easy. I wanted to press shift Y, I did control Y. What will happen? My macro is always active to run. So it will run. That might delete my rows and columns that I never wanted to delete. So as an advice, the kind of macro that you should be storing in this for beginners is only that does formatting, like coloring, putting borders, something that I can revert back very easily, but nothing that destroys your data. Right? So depending on how you want to run it, where you want to store your macros, these are the three choices you have. So going back, let me just delete this again or move it probably. So this is my starting position, record macro, like we decided we want to give the name transpose data, and control Y is the key, and I'm going to store it in, let's say, this workbook itself for now. If you want to give a description, you can click OK. And now onwards, any step that I take, whether it's right or wrong, my macro will record, create a code for it in the backend, and will repeat it exactly in the same manner. Something that you've done is what it can repeat. Something that you've not done, it cannot repeat. So one step down, select the cells, go one step up, transpose, come one step down, delete the rows. I'm not clearing the content, I'm completely deleting the rows. Select my end cell and stop recording. For stop recording, you will see there's a stop button at the bottom, or we can go back to our menu and have stop recording. Before you run your macros, please make sure you stop your macros. Otherwise, even running of the macro becomes a code and it goes, you know, whenever it's ending, it will say, okay, run it again. It will go back and run it again and again. So we need to stop our macros before we start running. Now the shortcut key was Control Y. So every time I press Control Y, the process gets repeated. So in this thing I could have done in 5 minutes. However, I finished in seconds. So that is what your macros are all about. Any questions? No questions. Okay, now if, let's say I want to delete my macro, if I want to view my codes, if I have forgotten my shortcut key, what do I do? Right? If you have n numbers of workbooks open, if you press Alt F8 on Excel, all the workbooks which are open and you select this choice, macros in all open workbooks, you will be looking at the names of all the macros that you've recorded in the open workbooks. Okay. That's how you get a list of macros in order to run it. Let's say, because it's very easy. Within a week, you will forget what the shortcut key was if you're not using it every day. So I forgot, I want to look back into which were my shortcut keys, what were my codes. So I press Alt F8. Once you press Alt F8, if you want to delete something, select that particular macro, hit the delete button. Let's say I've given a Control C as my shortcut key. I would wish to change my shortcut key. We're going to go to option. This is the place either to remember what was the shortcut key or to modify if you want. Right? And if you want to look at the code in the VB editor where it is clicked, where it is placed, then we click on edit. Once we click on edit, this is called the VB editor, and this is the code that got generated by Excel to do the process. If I want to go back to Excel, there's an icon over here. You can click that, or the shortcut key is Alt F11. So if I press Alt F11, I come back. Now, if I open a new workbook and let's say I put some new data. And again, I'm trying to do the same process of transposing. Now, even though there is no 9 data, there are only 4 data over here. When I press control Y, it still works because of my selection method that I picked. So these are your macros in short, right? And please remember, macros have their limitations also. Macros can only work in a fixed pattern. If the pattern keeps on changing, like in this case, if you see the pattern is exactly the same. There were 9 fields for each record and there was only 1 cell difference between each record. What if there was a changing cell difference? There was no difference between one of the records. There were 2 cells in between 2 records. Your Excel can't, your macros, recorded macros can't work with this because this is not consistent pattern. It has to work with consistent pattern. So when you're recording macros, make sure you have a consistent pattern. You develop a process for that and then start recording a macro. Otherwise, the macros fail. And then we have to move to VBA programming where we can record a macro and we can further edit the or change the codes or rewrite the codes in order to run that process. Right? Any questions from anyone? Anything that you do in Excel, sorting, filtering, VLOOKUPs, making pivots, making charts, anything that I can do on Excel can get recorded by my macros. The only thing you have to understand, if I'm doing something like I'm, another example of using a macro could be if I'm making weekly or the monthly summaries. Those are the fixed things that I do. Fixed number of cells would be there. Only thing that changes is the values. So I can record my whole process. Let's say when I dump the data, I got my raw data. First thing I have to do is format my whole entire data. So formatting goes as the first process. Second process is, let's say I want to create some summaries using pivots or some of the functions like COUNTIF, SUMIF, averages. So I can use those functions over there. And then once I've created a summary, I want to now create a chart. So this entire process, which takes you half an hour, 45 minutes, again can reduce in seconds. But the number of data that is there, the pattern of the data that is there has to be exactly same for recorded macros to work on it. If I have 20 records, not, it doesn't matter on the number of records, but what the columns are. If I have 5-6 columns, if I'm picking the summary values from the same column all the time, I can record a macro for that. Because I can, like I told you, we can make our programs macros dynamic depending on the selection methods. If I use the right selection method, the number of records would not matter to me. So anything and everything that you do in Excel, whatever you've learned in Excel so far, you can actually record the code for it. Auto filtering, advanced filtering, filtering, sorting, any functions that you're using, it can record each and everything for you. Okay, thank you all for attending this webinar. And if you have any questions, you can send your queries to info@ivyprofessionalschool. Thank you again.